أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم لقد أرسلنا رسلنا بالبينات وأنزلنا معهم الكتاب والميزان ليقوم الناس بالقسط صدق الله العظيم.
الحمد لله الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ومن يكسب إثما فإنما يكسبه على نفسه وكان الله عليما حكيما ومن يكسب خطيئة أو إثما ثم يرمي به بريئا فقد احتمل بهتانا وإثما مبينا صدق الله العظيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. اللهم ربنا ألهمنا رشدنا وأعذنا من شرور أنفسنا. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه. اللهم آنس وحشتنا في قبورنا وارحمنا بالقرآن العظيم. اللهم اجعله لنا إماما ونورا وهدى ورحمة. اللهم ذكرنا منهما نسينا وعلمنا منهما جهلنا وارزقنا تلاوته آناء الليل وآناء النهار واجعله لنا حجة يا رب العالمين آمين. Dear brothers and sisters and sons and daughters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. As you must have noted, we are starting our study today from ayah number 111 of Surah An-Nisa. Just to have a brief review, I told you that these ayat can be grouped regarding different addresses. In Surah An-Nisa, in some passages, the address is directed towards the Muslims positively, giving them the details of Sharia, giving them how to reform the society now. Now that it is your own society, you have your own society at Medina, you have the political authority here, now you can enforce your own laws, now you can reform the society in your own methods, in your own ways. Secondly, the address to the people of the book, the Jews and the Christians. Thirdly, the address towards the Munafiqeen. The most important element now at Medina was that of Munafiqeen, because it was the hidden enemy of the Muslims. And they had become a menace to the Muslim society and this, you know, budding Islamic state, we may call it. Although there is no address to them directly by the words, Ya ayyuhal munafiqoon, you will never find this word in the Quran. Always they are also addressed, Ya ayyuhal lazina amanu. Why? Because they profess to be Muslims. Legally they were Muslims. So they are also addressed by the words, Ya ayyuhal lazina amanu. But when we see to the contents of the ayah, then we can understand, here actually the address is to the munafiqeen. But then secondly, these three addresses, they are interspersed with each other. To review, the first 43 ayat, they were positive instructions to the Muslims, how to reform the society, what is the law of inheritance, how to protect the rights of women, how to protect the rights of orphans, etc., etc., how to have a sex discipline in your society, how to finish with the sex anarchy. All these things came in the ayat, in the beginning, 43 ayat. Then there was a brief reference to the people of the book, from ayah number 44 to ayah number 57. Then two very profound ayat, again positively towards the Muslims, given the basis of the Islamic State, how to conduct the affairs of the Islamic State. Ya ayyuha allatheena amanu ati'u Allaha wa ati'u ar-rasul wa ulil amri minkum fa in tanaza'tum fi shay'in farudduhu ila Allahi wal rasul in kuntum tu'minuna billahi wal yawmil akhir dhalika khairun wa ahsanu ta'wila. And after that starts a very long discourse, starting from ayah number 60, and it will end up in the ayah number 115. It's a continuous address to munafiqeen. And three subjects are discussed regarding them. Number one, total obedience to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That is essential. If you profess to be Muslims, you have to obey him in all respects. Even all personal disputes that may arise between you, you have to accept him as the arbiter. You have to accept him as the judge. فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ فِي مَا شَجَرَ بَيْنَهُمْ ثُمَّ لَا يَجِدُوا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَرَجًا مِمَّا قَضَيْتَ وَيُسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا. But this was very, you know, very difficult for them to swallow. A very bitter pill to swallow for the munafiqeen. He is also a man, human being. Why should we be obedient to him? We are ready to obey Allah. But why should we be obedient to him? You know, the same disease which today we have among the people who don't want to accept ahadith, who don't want to accept sunnah as the permanent source of Islamic law. They say, hey, Quran is sufficient for us. We don't need anything else. The same disease is appearing among the Muslims in this form. That was the attitude of the munafiqeen or Medina. We are not ready to obey Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We are ready to obey Allah, Allah's word. Secondly, qital fi sabilillah had become a very big burden for them. Risking their lives, going out to fight the enemies of Allah, risking their lives, spending their money and wealth and belongings. So we had a long discourse about that. Thirdly, and this concerned basically the munafiqeen, not of Medina, but munafiqeen at Makkah, munafiqeen in other tribes. For them, hijrah had been made obligatory. It was fard. You have to migrate to Medina now. And I told you the wisdom behind it. That now, because an offensive had to be taken against the Aimmat al-Kufr, the leaders of Kufr, they were in Makkah, the Quraysh. And you know, for that offensive, all the human resources that were available should have gathered at one place, at the base, so that an effective offensive could be launched from there. When Muslims were scattered, some are here, some are there, some are in that tribe, some are living in that tribe, in that corner of Arabian Peninsula. So how could, you know, that force be available, which was required for an effective offensive? So hijrah was made compulsory, obligatory. And it has also become a reason for munafiqeen, you know, because they were hesitating to leave their hearts and homes and families and the places where they were born, where they were brought up, where their ancestors, you know, they lay buried. Actually, it was very hard to do it. So these three things have been discussed, you know, in detail in this passage. Now we are in the middle of that. وَمَنْ يَكْسِبْ إِسْمًا فَإِنَّمَا يَكْسِبُهُ عَلَىٰ نَفْسِهِ. It's again a universal law. Whosoever earns a sin, verily he earns it against himself. You know, this iman bil akhirah, this faith in hereafter, it changes the outlook of human beings, absolutely. I have done something wrong to him. Well, actually, I have done something wrong to myself, because I will have to bear the punishment for that in the hereafter, which is the real life. وَإِنَّ دَارَ الْآخِرَةَ لَهِيَ الْحَيَوَانِ لَوْ كَانُوا يَعْلَمُونَ. So the outlook is absolutely changed. You have not done anything wrong to him. You have done something wrong to your own self, your own soul. You have doomed your own self. وَمَنْ يَكْسِبْ إِسْمًا فَإِنَّمَا يَكْسِبُهُ عَلَىٰ نَفْسِهِ وَكَانَ اللَّهُ عَلِيمًا حَكِيمًا. And Allah is ever knowing, all wise. وَمَنْ يَكْسِبْ خَطِيَّةً. And there is the second grade, you know, a higher level of this sin. And what is that? وَمَنْ يَكْسِبْ خَطِيَةً أَوْ إِسْمًا. Whosoever earns a sin or some other wrong deed, ثُمَّ يَرْمِ بِهِ بَرِيًّا, and then he casts the blame on somebody else who is innocent. I do something and put the blame on him. He has done it. Now this is a crime of a higher degree. فَقَدْ اِحْتَمَلَ بُهْتَانًا وَإِسْمًا عَظِيمًا بِإِسْمًا مُبِينًا. But such a person has taken upon himself the burden, a very heavy burden of false charge, false allegation, and a very clear and manifest sin. So these are two ayats, you know, and they have something common between them in the subject. And there is an incident in the background. A munafiq who was a Muslim, he committed a theft. Then he put the blame on a Jew. They knew, because, you know, these Jews are weak, we are strong, our tribes are strong, Aus and Khazraj. And you know, because Aus and Khazraj are mainly Muslims, so I will get the support of the Muslim society and I will go scot-free, and this Jew will be blamed for this theft. But when it was investigated, he was found to be guilty himself. But now his relatives came and they took his side. No, he is our brother, he is a Muslim, he must not be punished. So it became a hard issue for Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You know, these things are practical examples, you know. To run the affairs of a state is not an easy job. You have to look to the right, to the left. But you know, because Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the Prophet of Allah, so he decided rightly. And he gave the punishment to the Muslim, although he was a legal Muslim. So that is the incident. مَنْ يَكْسِبْ إِسْمًا فَإِنَّمَا يَكْسِبُهُ عَلَىٰ نَفْسِهِ. First of all, he committed theft, and he took the burden of his sin on him. And to add fuel to fire, وَمَنْ يَكْسِبْ خَطِيَّةً أَوْ إِسْمًا ثُمَّ يَرْمِ بِهِ بَرِيًّا فَقَدْ اِحْتَمَلَ بُهْتَانًا وَإِسْمًا مُبِينًا وَلَوْلَا فَضْلُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكَ وَرَحْمَتُهُ. And O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, had there not been the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and bounty upon you, لَحَمَّتْ طَائِفَةٌ مِّنْهُمْ, a group amongst these had tried and intended, أَنْ يُدِلُّوكَ, to lead you astray, to lead you on the wrong path, to lead you to the injustice. وَمَا يُدِلُّونَ إِلَّا أَنفُسَهُمْ. But because Allah is with you, they can't take you to the right, to the wrong path, but they have taken themselves to the wrong path. They have taken the ism and they have taken the burden on themselves. وَمَا يَضُرُّونَكَ مِنْ شَيْءٍ, and they will never be able to harm you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah is your protector. وَأَنزَلَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ, and this is one of the manifestations of Allah's bounty on you. That أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent down the book and the wisdom on you. وَعَلَّمَكَ مَا لَمْ تَكُنْ تَعْلَمْ, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taught you what you didn't know before. وَكَانَ فَضْلُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكَ عَظِيمًا, and you know the bounty of Allah on you is very great. صلى الله عليه وسلم. لَا خَيْرَ فِي كَسِرٍ مِّن نَجْوَاهُمْ, there's no good in most of their secret parleys and secret talks. Najwa, two, three persons going away and talking to each other. This is called Najwa. You should say out whatever you have to say in the open. But you know, groupings, then intrigues, then sitting in different corners, and then you know they are talking to each other. This is called Najwa. لَا خَيْرَ فِي كَسِيرٍ مِّن نَجْوَاهُمْ, in these secret meetings and secret negotiations and secret, you know, parleys and secret talks, most of them they are without any good. Illa, but there is an exception. Illa man amara bi sadaqatin, except for that person who commands someone to give something in charity. Now to ask in public is not good. If you persuade in private, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you wealth, you should, you know, spare something for the cause of Allah, for the cause of the poor. So if you are doing this job, privately and separately, then it is good. One exception. إِلَّا مَنْ أَمَرَ بِصَدَقَةٍ أَوْ مَعْرُوفٍ. Or any other good advice is being given. Personal advice. If you advise a person in public, maybe he feels offended. He thinks himself to be superior to me, so he is advising me. But if you privately go and tell him that this is better for you, and this attitude that you have taken is not good, it would have been much better had you taken that attitude. So that is also an exception. أَوْ إِصْلَاحٍ بَيْنَ النَّاسِ. And the third is, when you are trying to bring some reconciliation between two parties, there also you are required to talk to them separately, then come to the other party and talk to them separately. So these are the three exceptions. All other secret negotiations are without any good. لَا خَيْرَ فِي كَثِيرٍ مِّن نَجْوَاهُمْ إِلَّا مَنْ أَمَرَ بِصَدَقَةٍ أَوْ مَعْرُوفٍ أَوْ إِصْلَاحٍ بَيْنَ النَّاسِ وَمَنْ يَفْعَلْ ذَلِكَ. Whosoever does these three things, or one of these three things, ابْتِغَى مَرْضَاتِ اللَّهِ, and in doing these things, actually he wants the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah be pleased with me, فَصَوْفَ نُوْتِيهِ أَجْرًا عَظِيمًا. To such a person or to such persons, we shall give a very big reward. وَمَنْ يُشَاقِقِ الرَّسُولِ. Now this is the last ayah of this passage. We started from ayah number 60, in which, you know, actually, indirectly, the munafiqeen are being addressed. These all, you know, diseases which have been considered and discussed here, they were in the munafiqeen. وَمَنْ يُشَاقِقِ الرَّسُولَ. Whosoever becomes hostile towards the Messenger of Allah. That was the last stage, you know, because just as you know, TB, tuberculosis, had three stages. First stage, second stage, third stage. And when, you know, somebody had gone to the third stage of tuberculosis, you know, then it was thought now it is incurable. The same way, you know, nifaq, first stage is telling lies, making lame excuses. Second stage is, now you are swearing by Allah. Wallah, I wanted to go. Actually, there was this reason I couldn't go to the battle. And third is, you feel enmity for the Muslims, and especially for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He had put us in this difficult position, because he has started this movement. And by this movement, now there is a conflict in Arabia. Now there is wars are going, and we are required to go to fight. And this is actually all due to him. So there was personal enmity towards Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the hearts of the munafiqeen. And enmity towards the Muslims, good Muslims. Why? Well, they are always ready to go. Whenever there is a call, they respond positively. They don't look to the right or to the left. They don't see what are the risks involved. And they are ready to sacrifice everything. So actually, because they respond positively to every call, we become prominent because we are not responding positively. So actually they are to blame. So these are the two reasons of shiqaq. And this is the highest level of nifaq. And when nifaq reaches this level, it becomes incurable. وَمَنْ يُشَاقِقِ الرَّسُولَ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيَّنَ لَهُ الْهُدَىٰ. Whosoever becomes hostile to the Messenger of Allah, after the guidance has been made manifest and evident. Now it was, you know, at least 17 years had passed from the beginning of Wahi. Most of the Quran had been revealed. All the guidance has come to you already. When all this guidance has come to you, and even now if you are hostile to the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَيَتَّبِعْ غَيْرَ سَبِيلِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. And whosoever is following not the way of the Muslims. The way of the Muslim is, when they are called, they say labbaik. When they are called to spend, they bring everything they have and contribute. This is the way of the Muslims. So actually, whosoever is hostile to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and whosoever is not following the way of the mu'mineen, nuwallihi ma tawalla. We also turn him in the direction in which he has himself chosen. He has chosen the direction of hell. Well, hell to you. Go. Nuwallihi ma tawalla. Now we don't care for him. Now we don't want to bring him back. Now he has taken this direction. He has reached that level of nifaq. Let him go to hell. No allahi ma tawalla wa nuslihi jahannam, and we shall throw him in jahannam wasat masira, and it's a very bad destination. So this is the final, you know, in this long passage starting from ayah number 60, and it has come to ayah number 115. It has been discussing all this passage discusses actually nifaq and munafiqeen and the various diseases in them and the various forms of manifestation of nifaq. But this ayah is important in another way also. And that is, you know, it is the basis of the authenticity of ijma' in Islam. You know, the sources of Islamic law are, number one, Quran. Sources of Sharia, Quran, number one. Sunnah of the Prophet, number two. And ijma', number three. Ijma' of the days of the Prophet, ijma' of the days of the companions, ijma' of the period of Khilafat al-Rashidah. Now, this has been accepted by all four schools of fiqh among the Sunnis. Hanafi, Maliki, Shafi'i, Hanbali. They all accept Jum'ah is the third source of law in Islamic Sharia. But Imam Shafi'i says, I wondered if Ijma' is so important, why there is no mention of it in Quran? And Imam Shafi'i is a big scholar. And he is actually the founder of that discipline of Usul al-Fiqh. This discipline started with Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah. So he says that I went through Quran 300 times only to find any place to which I can point out that this is the basis of Ijma'. 300 times I didn't find anything. But now on the 301st chance, my eyes, you know, stopped here. Here is the place of Ijma'. Sabilul Mu'mineen, the way of the Mu'mins, the way of the believers, it becomes authentic by itself. And this is Ijma'. وَمَنْ يُشَاقِقِ الرَّسُولَ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيَّنَ لَهُ الْهُدَى وَيَتَّبِعْ غَيْرَ سَبِيلِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ نُوَلِّهِ مَا تَوَلَّا وَنُسْلِهِ جَهَنَّمْ وَسَاتْ مَسِيرًا. Now, again to the Muslims. But this can again be divided into two parts, A, and that is regarding shirk and the pagan background. After all the Muslims, you know, in that society, they belong to, and their ancestors were the worshippers of idols, etc., etc. So maybe there is some of those past influences and traditions present in some of them, if not all of them, in some of them there can be some traces, some, you know, some effect of that background. So here also we find in a very brief passage, it appears to be as if we are reading some Makki ayat, this portion. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَنْ يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ. First of all, and this ayah, these words are appearing for the second time now in this very surah. Allah Ta'ala is never going to pardon and forgive this sin of shirk, that something or somebody be associated with him as a partner or as equal. This is the biggest sin, biggest crime, unpardonable. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَنْ يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ. Whatever is lesser and smaller than this, it can be hoped that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will condone it. But it is not an open license that you go on doing everything else except shirk and it is licensed to you and it is insured for you that Allah will forgive it. No, but it can be hoped. وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلَكَ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ. Not for all. For whomsoever he wills, he pleases. وَمَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ ضَلَّ ضَلَالًا بَعِيدًا. And verily, who commits shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, associates anything or anybody with him as partner or equal, well, he has gone astray and he has gone very far off, deviated very far off from the right path. إِن يَدْعُونَ مِن دُونَهِ إِلَّا إِنَاسَ. Now that was the shirk of the pagan Arabs. They, you know, had female deities, their goddesses, Lat, female, Muannas, Uzza, Uzza is the feminine of Al-Aziz. Al-Uzza, Al-Aziz. Al-Akbar, Al-Kubra. In the same way, Al-Aziz, Al-Uzza. Lat, Manat, Uzza, these were the female deities. In yaduna min dunahi illa ilasa. They are not praying to or worshipping besides Allah, but female deities, their goddesses. وَإِن يَدْعُونَ إِلَّا شَيْطَانًا مَرِيدًا. This is only apparently that they are calling and praying, you know, and invoking Lat or Manat or Uzza. Actually, they are calling and praying to Shaitan. The Shaitan who is a rebel against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Actually, it is Shaitan who is being addressed. لَعْنَهُ اللَّهُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had cursed him. وَقَالَ لَا تَخِذَنَّ مِنْ عِبَادِكَ نَصِيبًا مَفْرُوضًا. And he also had said it in a challenging mood. Oh Allah, I shall prove to you and I shall take a share from your, these creatures, your men, these human beings, Nasibam Mafruza, a part, a portion, which is appointed and absolutely clear. I will get them. وَلَا أُضِلَّنَّهُمْ. I will lead them astray. وَلَا أُمَنِّيَنَّهُمْ. I will engage them in vain hopes, in wishful thinking. Oh, Allah is bountiful. He will forgive. So you follow lana. We will be pardoned. لَن تَمَسَّنَ النَّارُ إِلَّا أَيَّامًا مَعْدُودَاتٍ. The fire of hell will not be able to touch us, except for only a few days. These are the amani. لَأُضِلَّنَّهُمْ وَلَأُمَنِّيَنَّهُمْ. وَلَعَامُرَنَّهُمْ فَلَيُبَتِّكُنَّ آذَانَ الْأَنْعَامَ. I shall command them, and they will slit the cattle's ears. Why? Because when some, you know, cow or something else, some camel, that was given to some idol, in the name of idol, set free, they due to slit their ears, as a sign, that this is now a sacred thing. Nobody touch to them. Just we find in Hindu society also, even today, we find that the cattle are, you know, roaming, nobody can stop them because they have been donated to in the name of some, you know, devata and some god, etc., etc. وَلَآمُرَنَّهُمْ فَلَيُغَيِّرُنَّ خَلْقَ اللَّهِ. And I shall command them and they will alter the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And now we are playing with this creation of Allah, with genetics and genetical engineering. We will be playing havoc with the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This has started. And the other form was females imitating males. Males imitating females. وَلَا يُغَيِّرُنَّ خَلْقَ اللَّهِ. Allah has made them something else. Allah had made these hair grow on males. We shave it. No, we want to look like females. This is also a change in the khalq of Allah. This is nature, going against nature. Why? The sunnah of the prophets, all the prophets, all the messengers of Allah, and we are imitating this west. Why? This is again, you know, changing. Because the fitrah, Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, all these things, you know, fitrah is that which was given to us through Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. So this is changing. And unisex dress. Somebody is going and you can't say whether he is a male or she is a female. You can't know. So all these things, you know, they belong to this category. And this is going to its climax through this genetical engineering. وَلَآمُرَنَّهُمْ فَلَيُغَيِّرُنَّ خَلْقَ اللَّهِ وَمَنْ يَتَّخِذْ شَيْطَانَ وَلِيًّا مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ فَقَدْ خَسِرَ خُسْرَانًا مُبِينًا. And whosoever takes Satan as his protector and friend instead of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, oh, he is in a great loss, in a manifest loss. He has lost his career, his future. Ya'iduhum. This Satan promises them, although his promises are false. Mayumannihim. And engages them in vain hopes, in wishful thinking. Wama ya'iduhumu shaitanu illa ghurura. But whatever the shaitan, the Satan is promising to them, is nothing but delusion and deception. أُولَٰئِكَ مَعْوَاهُمْ جَهَنَّمْ وَلَا يَجِدُونَ عَنْهَا مَحِيصًا. For all these, the abode is hell. And they will not find any way out of it. Once thrown in it, they will have no escape, no way out of it. And on the contrast, as I told you, wherever there is mention of the people of the hell, then now people who are going to paradise. وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ As for those who have real belief, real iman, وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ And what's the proof of their real belief? That is the عَمَلُ الصَّالِحِ Their deeds are good. سَنُدْخِلُهُمْ جَنَّاتٍ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَعْتِ الْأَنْهَارِ Soon we are going to make them enter the garden underneath which rivers will be flowing. خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا أَبَدًا And they will abide there, they will live there forever, forever. وَعَدَ اللَّهِ حَقًّا A true promise from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't harbor any doubts in your mind. It's a promise from Allah. And you know it's a true promise. وَمَنْ أَصْدَقُ مِنَ اللَّهِ قِيلًا Who can be more true in his saying than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself? So have full confidence that if you are fulfilling these two conditions of iman and amal salih, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will fulfill his promise. And he is أَصْدَقُ قِيلًا لَيْسَ بِأَمَانِيَّكُمْ Now this word again appears here. Amani, what is Amani? Wishful thinking. Well, we belong to the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We shall have the intercession. We shall all be saved. We shall go directly to heaven, directly to paradise. Well, where has it been guaranteed in the Quran? Could you tell me, please? But this is Amani. لَنْ تَمَسَّنَ النَّارُ إِلَّا أَيَّامًا مَعْدُودَاتٍ Where in Torah have we given you that guarantee? Could you tell us? No. It's your amani, your wishful thinking. Nahnu abna'u Allah wa ahibba'uhu. We are like sons to Allah. We are very loved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are beloveds of Allah. Has he said it so in any of his books? No. It's amani. Laysa bi amaniyakum, O Muslims. Beware, nothing will be decided according to your wishful thinking. Wala amani ahlil kitab. Nor the amani of ahlil kitab. These amanis, these umniyats, these wishful thinkings, these false beliefs that you have concocted yourselves. Man ya'mal su'an yujza bihi. Whosoever commits something wrong, something bad, something ill and evil, He will be recompensed for that. This is the law. There's no exception to this law. وَلَا يَجِدْ لَهُ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ وَلِيًّا وَلَا نَصِيرًا And he will never find against the judgment of Allah, against the accountability of Allah, anybody to protect and anybody to help. No protection, no help. If you have done wrong, you'll have to face it. مَنْ وَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ صَالِحْ مَنْ يَعْمَلْ سُوًا يُجْزَ بِهِ وَلَا يَجِدْ لَهُ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ وَلِيًّا وَلَا نَصِيرًا And again here contrast, as for the Muslims, وَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِنَ الصَّالِحَاتِ Whosoever is doing good deeds, virtuous acts, مِنْ ذَكَرٍ أَوْ أُنْثَى irrespective of whether he is a male or she is a female, وَهُوَ مُؤْمِن But the condition is that she or he must be a mu'min. Good deeds there can be in the unbelievers also. They can also found charitable institutions. They might be doing something good for the humanity. But if they don't believe in Allah, if they don't believe in Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if they don't believe in the hereafter, then that good deeds and charities are going to be no good to them in the hereafter. So that is a condition. But whether he is a male or she is a female, it is. Irrelevant. وَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِنَ الصَّالِحَاتِ مِنْ ذَكَرٍ أَوْ أُنْثَى وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٌ فَأُولَٰئِكَ يَدْخُلُونَ الْجَنَّةِ These people will enter paradise, heaven. لَا يُظْلَمُونَ نَقِيرًا And they will not be wronged, even equal to the speck of a dead stone. وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ دِيمًا مِمَنْ أَسْلَمَ وَجْهَهُ لِلَّهِ وَهُوَ مُحْسِنٌ And who can be better in religion? Then the one who submits his face to Allah. And because this face is the most respectable part of our body. What does it mean? He has submitted his whole self before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Face actually is the most important part of human body. وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ دِينًا مِمَّنْ أَسْلَمَ وَجْهُ لِلَّهِ وَهُوَ مُحْسِنٌ. Now here, most of the translators I find, they have committed a mistake. Muhsin here is not meant doing good to others. This is the higher level of Islam. Islam, Iman, Ihsan. Very fine level of Islam. Subtle level. High level. Where it has become Ihsan. As we find in Hadith Jibreel, which is called Sunnah. First question, what is Islam? Number two, what is Iman? Number three, what is Ihsan? Wallahu yuhibbul muhsinin. When you know his religion becomes very fine, very beautiful. His character is very admirable. When he is praying from the depths of his heart. When he is loving Allah the most, from the depths of his heart. What is Ihsan? And the Prophet replied, أَنْتَعْبُدَ اللَّهَ كَأَنَّكَ تَرَاهُ فَإِنَّمْ تَكُنْ تَرَاهُ فَإِنَّهُ يَرَاكُ. That you obey Allah, you worship Allah, as if you are seeing Him. Or at least if you are not seeing Him, at least you should have the feeling that He is seeing you. فَإِلَّمْ تَكُنْ تَرَاهُ فَإِنَّهُ يَرَاكُ. This is the Ihsan. فَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ دِينًا مِمَّنْ أَسْلَمَ وَجْهُ لِلَّهِ وَهُوَ مُحْسَنٌ اتَّبَعَ مِلَّةَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ حَنِيفًا. And he follows the millah, the method, and the way of Ibrahim. And Ibrahim was an upright person, absolutely pure in faith. Harif, yaksu, upright and pure faith. وَاتَّخَذَ اللَّهُ إِبْرَاهِيمَ خَلِيلًا. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had taken Ibrahim as a friend. Now this is the highest degree. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is speaking of Ibrahim as Khalil. Khullah in Arabic means very deep love. Khalil, you know, is much higher than Rafiq. Rafiq is a, you know, you may call Rafiq a colleague or a comrade. These things are, you know, at the level of Rafiq. But you know, Khalil, and let me quote here one saying of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that can give you a something, you know, what Khalil is in Arabic. The Prophet said, لَوْ كُنْتُ مُتَّخِذًا خَلِيلًا لَتَّخَذْتُ أَبَا بَكْرٍ خَلِيلًا. If I could take anybody as Khalil for me, I would have taken Abu Bakr. Even Abu Bakr didn't reach that level. لَوْ كُنْتُ مُتَّخِذًا خَلِيلًا لَتَّخَذْتُ أَبَا بَكْرٍ خَلِيلًا. So Khalil is a very high level. وَاتَّخَذَ اللَّهُ إِبْرَاهِيمَ خَلِيلًا. He is Abul Anbiya. The forefather of hundreds of prophets. All the prophets of the Old Testament, who are they? The progeny of Ibrahim through Ishaq. And then the final and complete messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ar-Rasulul Kamil. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Again a son of Ibrahim through Ismail. Inni ja'iluka lin-nasi imama. That was one dimension. Inni ja'iluka lin-nasi imama. And here, وَاتَّخَذَ اللَّهُ إِبْرَاهِيمَ خَلِيلًا. In relation to the humanity, you are imam. In relation to me, you are my khalil. And in relation to the messengers of Allah and prophets, you are the father of so many prophets and messengers of Allah. That is the position of Ibrahim. That is why, you know, we invoke in Darood, in Salah, Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ala ali Muhammadin kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim innaka hamidun majid. Allahumma barik ala Muhammadin wa ala ali Muhammadin kama barakta ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim innaka hamidun majid. Walillahi ma fi samawati wa ma fi al-ard. And to Allah belongs all that is in the heavens and that is in the earth. وَكَانَ اللَّهُ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ مُحِيطًا. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is encompassing all the things. He has encircled as if everything, nothing is beyond his control. Now, the second part of this address to Muslims. The first part was basic iman and shirk and amal-e-saleh. All these things which were very basic. These actually are the subjects which are discussed in detail in the Makki surahs. Here a brief, you may say, survey. But now again to the Muslims. Regarding the reformation of the society, the rules of conduct now in the society. وَيَسْتَفْتُونَكَ فِي النِّسَىٰ. In the very first section of this surah, there were some commandments about women, about orphans. But there arose into the minds of the people certain questions and doubts about those things. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is now explaining. People came to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to ask questions about it. What does it mean? How can we do it? Now these questions. يَسْتَفْتُونَكَ فِي النِّسَىٰ. O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they want a pronouncement about women. قُلِ اللَّهُ يُفْتِيكُمْ فِيهِنْ. Tell them Allah is going to pronounce, give you a pronouncement regarding women. وَمَا يُطْلَى عَلَيْكُمْ فِي الْكِتَابِ فِي يَتَامَ النِّسَاءِ. And what has been already, which is recited to you in the book about the orphan women, يَتَامَ النِّسَاءِ. In ayah number 3 of this very surah, you know, the mention was there. But people, I told you, the munkirin sunnah, who don't take sunnah to be the exegesis of Quran, to be the authentic or exegesis of Quran, they interpret it in different way. But here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blocked their way. He has made his commandment absolutely clear. That is the yataman nisa, the orphan girls. اللاتي لا توتونهن ما كتب لهن وترغبون ان تنكحوهن. You want to marry them. They are under your guardianship. You want to marry them. Because they are orphans, you will not have to pay the dowry. And nobody will be there to ask for their rights. لا توتونهن ما كتب الله لهن. You don't want to pay to them what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has fixed for them. وترغبون ان تنكحوهن. And you want to marry them. وَالْمُسْتَضَعْفِينَ مِنَ الْمِلْدَانِ. And you know, the oppressed people among the, oppressed ones among the children, وَانْتَقُومُوا لِلْيَتَامَ بِالْقِسْطِ. And that you should establish justice about orphans. Now it is, قَامَ بِي أَنْ تُقِيمُوا لِلْيَتَامَ بِالْقِسْطِ. إِقَامَ بِي بِالْقِسْطِ, with justice. So you have to establish justice. وَمَا تَفْعَلُوا مِنْ خَيْرٍ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ بِهِ عَلِيمًا. And whatever good you do, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala very well knows it. Don't think it will go in vain or in waste. Now this is, the thing has now been cleared. If there could be any doubt regarding the explanation of ayah number 3 of this surah, I don't have time to repeat it now. Now second issue. وَإِنِ امْرَأَةٌ خَافَتْ مِنْ بَعْلِهَا نُشُوزًا. In the beginning of this surah we discussed, if a husband feels that the wife is becoming disobedient, she is not behaving as she should, then what to do? That was given in the beginning. Now the converse of it. Maybe that a woman thinks that the husband is cruel to him. He is not paying her due attention, for example. After all, she is in wedlock with a person. She is the wife, he is the husband. She has some rights over him. And he is not performing the duties. وَإِنِ امْرَأَةٌ خَافَتْ مِنْ بَعْلِهَا نُشُوزًا أَوْ عِرَازًا. If a woman fears from her husband, نُشُوزًا, that is oppression or cruelty, أَوْ عِرَازًا, or neglect, ignoring. Now he is ignoring her. Not coming to her, not meeting her. So these things, you know, what should you do? فَلَا جُنَاهَ عَلَيْهِمَا أَن يُسْلِحَا بَيْنَهُمَا سُلْحَا. There will be no blame on them if they fix some new terms between them. The woman can say, okay, I let you have part of the dowry that you paid to me. Okay. But live with me in a ma'roof way. In a justifiable way. So actually anything, a new treaty can be made. They can adjust the things between them so that they can live together. And they can live as real wife and husbands, because that is the essence of the family life. وَالصُّلْحُ خَيْرٌ. And you know, peace and treaty, this is much better. even if you have to give up something. وَأُحْزِرَتِ الْأَلْفُزُ الشُّحْ. Verily, these inner souls of man, the basic and the baser selves in man, there is, you know, greed in it. Woman will also say, I don't want to forego the part of the dowry that you paid to me, but to make some reconciliation, to make things better, if you can do it, you must do it. وَإِن تُحْسِنُوا وَتَتَّقُوا. But if you adopt a good attitude, and you have the regard of Allah, taqwa of Allah, you are God conscious, you are Allah conscious, you have Allah in your mind, تَتَّقُوا, and you are trying to save yourself from Allah's displeasure. فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ خَبِيرًا. So whatever you are doing, Allah is very well aware of it. وَلَن تَسْتَطِيعُوا. Third, because it was said in the beginning, if you want to have more than one vice, you have to be, to do full justice between them. All the things that can be measured or weighed must be given equally. Your time equal. The time you are passing with this wife must be equal to the time you are passing with that wife. The money that you are giving to this wife, the equal sum must be paid to the other wife. The dress, what type of dress you are providing to them, you have to provide here also. All the things that can be weighed and measured. But you know, there is one thing which is not in the control of man, and that is his heart. He might have love for one more than the other. And this is beyond the control of human beings. So that is now made clear here. وَلَن تَسْتَطِيُوا أَن تَعْدِلُوا بَيْنَ النِّسَاءِ وَلَوْ حَرَصْتُمْ. And it is impossible for you, in this respect, to do justice to the women. Although you might be eager to do that, but you can't do it. فَلَا تَمِيلُوا كُلَّ الْمَيْلِ. But don't incline towards one absolutely. فَتَذَرُوهَا كَالْمُعَلَّقَةِ. So as to leave the other one as suspended in between. She is neither married, nor, you know, without, nor with a husband, or neither without a husband. This is muallaq, hanging in between. Don't leave her in suspense. You have gone to one side only, and the other wife is now muallaq. وَالْتَذَرُوهَا كَالْمُعَلَّقَةِ. وَإِن تُصْلِحُوا وَتَتَّقُوا فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ غَفُورًا رَحِيمًا. And if you make amendments, amend your ways, and number two, if you have real taqwa, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ever forgiving and ever merciful. وَإِن يَتَفَرَّقَا. Number four, you know talaq, separation. أَبْغَضُ الْحَلَالِ. There's a hadith, the Prophet said, إِنَّ أَبْغَضَ الْحَلَالِ إِنَّ اللَّهِ الطَّلَاقِ. The worst among the halal things, the most hated by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but it is halal. Although it is halal, it is very hateful in the eyes of Allah. أَبْغَضُ الْحَلَالِ إِنَّ اللَّهِ الطَّلَاقِ. But if a wife and a husband, they are not living properly, they have tried all the means to reconcile to each other, but you know, they have absolutely different temperaments, different priorities. So they can't, they are incompatible, so to say, with each other. So now it's no use keeping them together. The house, you know, the family will not have the peace which is required, that love which is required. So actually then it is better to separate. This ayah is encouraging separation and divorce. Please note it. And this is the balance in divine law. Something is very bad, very bad, very bad, but permissible. And in certain condition, it becomes desirable. You must try your best to maintain this relationship of marriage. But if you know, after all the methods that you have tried of reconciliation, you have failed, then it's better to separate. وَإِن يَتَفَرَّقَا. And if they separate, يُغْنِ اللَّهُ كُلَّم مِّن سَعَتِهِ. Allah will provide each one from his abundance. Now maybe that Allah gives this woman a better husband with whom she can live in a better way. And Allah will provide to this male also, to this husband also, a better wife, which is more compatible in her manners and ways with this person. So that is, إِن يَتَفَرَّقَا. If they decide to separate, yughnillahu kullam min saatihi wa kana Allahu wasi'an hakima. And Allah is all accommodating. Allah's prayers, they are not limited. He can produce a better wife for you, provide a better wife for you and a better husband for her. Kana Allahu wasi'an alima and hakima, and he's all wise. Walillahi ma fis samawati wa ma fil ard. Again, you must know, everything belongs to him, not to you, not to anybody else. To Allah belongs everything, all the things which are in the heavens or in the earth. وَلَقَدْ وَسَّيْنَا الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابِ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ. And we had advised and admonished those also who were given the book before you, O Muslims, وَإِيَّاكُمْ. And we are advising you also, أَنِ اتَّقُوا اللَّهِ, that have taqwa of Allah. You know, all these rules and regulations and do's and don'ts will go in vain if there is no taqwa. Man will play with the rules. This happens. Law, you know, can be made an article of play, a game. But if you have real taqwa, then these instructions will be beneficial. See the wordings. وَلِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَقَدْ وَصَّيْنَا الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ وَإِيَّاكُمْ أَنِ اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ. We advise them also, and we are advising you also. They were the former Muslim Ummah, and now you are the Muslim Ummah. They were the representatives of Allah on earth, and now you are occupying the same position. So we admonish them also, and we are admonishing you also. أَنِ اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَإِنْ تَكْفُرُوا فَإِنَّ لِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. Now here kufr doesn't mean unbelieving. Here kufr is as opposed to shukr. If you act thanklessly, we have given you this position. If you are not grateful, or if you disregard Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَإِنَّ لِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. What harm can you do to Allah by disregarding him or disregarding his laws and of Sharia? To him belongs all the things which are in the heavens and in the earth. وَكَانَ اللَّهُ غَنِيًّا حَمِيدًا. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is self-sufficient. He needs none, he needs nothing. وَحَمِيدًا. Hamida, he is praiseworthy. He doesn't need any praise, he is the praised one, himself. وَلِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. You are seeing how many times these words have been repeated here. لِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. Don't think that you own something and you have the authority. And if a woman is there in you know, this wedlock with you, now you can do anything to her that you like. No. You are also bondsman to Allah. You will be held responsible on the day of judgment. If there is any ill treatment from your side to your wives, to the orphans, or to the weaker elements of the society, don't think you will go scot-free. You will have to, you know, face the grand accountability of the day of judgment. وَلِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَكَفَى بِاللَّهِ وَكِيلًا إِنْ يَشَى يُذْهِبْكُمْ أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ. If Allah pleases, He can finish you, O mankind. وَيَعْتِ لِآخَرِينَ. He can bring another creation. He created you, He can create any other creation. Don't think that the creative activity of Allah has come to an end. Now He cannot create any other creature. Although He has raised you to a very high pinnacle, very high position. Ashraful makhlukat. وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي آدَمَ وَحَمَلْنَاهُمْ فِي الْبَرِّ وَالْبَعْرِ وَرَزَقْنَاهُمْ مِنَ الطَّيِّبَاتِ وَفَضَّلْنَاهُمْ عَلَىٰ كَثِيرٍ مِّمَّنْ خَلَقْنَا تَفْضِيلًا. We have given you all that positions. But don't think we can finish with you, all of you, and we can bring another creation. وَإِنْ يَشَعْ يُذْهِبْكَ أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ وَيَعْتِ بِآخَرِينَ وَكَانَ اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ ذَلِكَ قَدِيرًا. Allah is, verily, Allah is powerful enough to do it. مَنْ كَانَ يُرِيدُ سَوَابَ الدُّنْيَا فَعِنْدَ اللَّهِ سَوَابُ الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ. Very beautiful. Whosoever has decided only to get the reward in this world, woe to him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has both the things, the reward of this world also and akhirah also. Tu hi nada chand kaliyon par qanaat kar gaya, warna gulshan mein ilaaje tangiye dama bhi tha. You have limited yourself to this world, the gains of this world, the comforts of this world, the luxuries of this world, the fame of this world, the power of this world, and it is nothing as compared to akhirah. وَمَا الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا فِي الْآخِرَةِ إِلَّا قَلِيلٌ. So it's a very beautiful way of exhortation. Why have you confined yourself? مَنْ كَانَ يُرِيدُ ثَوَابَ الدُّنْيَا فَعِنْدَ اللَّهِ ثَوَابُ الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ وَكَانَ اللَّهُ سَمِيعًا بَصِيرًا. And verily, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ever listening, ever seeing. Nothing is hidden from his eyes. Now the last ayah is very profound. Here you know this section is ending. The address to the Muslims. Again we shall find the address towards Munafiqun from ayah number 136. But this ayah is most profound. This discourse addressed to the Muslims ending with this ayah. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu kunu qawwameena bil qist shuhada lillah. Oh, you who profess to believe. Oh, you who believe. Stand up for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Qawwameena bil qist. Qama be, I said. To establish something. Qawwameena bil qist. Establishing justice in this world. Just social order to be established. All types of injustice and cruelty and exploitation to be done away with. And this is your duty. We have made you the best ummah. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, kunu qawwameena bil qist shuhada lillah. You should become witnesses for Allah. You know, Jehovah's witnesses. A very good term. Jehovah. This is the name for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Witnesses of Allah. And actually, we are the witnesses for Allah. Shuhada linnas. Wa kazalika ja'alnaakum ummatan wasatal. Litakunu shuhada shahida. So be witnesses for Allah. Now witness, you know, very beautiful, please understand. Whenever you are testifying in any case, in any dispute, your testimony is going against one party in favor of the other party. Or against this party, then naturally it is in favor of the other, against the other. So we have with witness either lam or Allah. Shahida lahu. He testified in his favor. Shahida alayhi. He testified against him. Shahida lahu or shahida alayhi. Just as we have in a hadith, Al-Quran hujjatun laka aw alayka. This Quran is an argument either in your favor or against you. Either it will intercede before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Oh Allah, this bondman of yours loved me much. He wet me. He pondered over me. He acted upon me. So accept my intercession for him. It is for you. And it can be against also. Oh Allah, this fellow, he professed that I am the book of Allah. He never read me. Or recited me without understanding. Even a newspaper he was not reading without understanding. But he was reciting me without understanding. So it will be a witness against you. Al-Quran hujjatun laka wa alayk. But we shall continue this discourse in the next session, inshallah. Aqulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullah li wa lakum wa li sa'iril muslimin wal muslimat.
Allahu akbar.
The Islamic Organization of North America, IONA, is an organization dedicated to reviving the Quran into the hearts of Muslims while bringing its message to non-Muslims. The obligations of a Muslim as ordained by the Quran and Sunnah can be understood as having four levels. 1. A Muslim is required to develop real faith and conviction, iman, in one's heart. 2. A Muslim is required to live a life of complete submission to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. 3. A Muslim is required to propagate and disseminate the message of Islam to humanity as a whole. 4. A Muslim is required to try his utmost in establishing the just Islamic order. The first and foremost objective of establishing IONA is to assist the Muslims in North America to uphold and implement these obligations, first on themselves, their families, inform their friends, and then to invite the non-Muslims to Islam. The ultimate goal is to seek Allah's pleasure and salvation in the hereafter. For more information about IONA, please visit us at www.tanzim.us. You may also email us at info@tanzeem.us or call our toll-free number 866-779-IONA. Join us. Together we can make a difference.